I mean, help me out. I think I got enough juice on you. You got a charger tonight? Oh, thank you.
This show is being sponsored by Worldwide Flavor Network. If you are looking to have your own radio show, come and join us here on WWFN Online Radio. Contact us via our website, www.worldwideflavornetwork.com.
You can share it from our page too if you want to, so they can see both of y'all and all that good stuff.
Oh, I already went live.
Oh, are you on live?
Yeah.
I was just wondering. Hi, this is Tony Reid, the fitness trainer, health coach, and life
hey, everybody. Get ready to start. Stay tuned. We got this. This gentleman here is going to be talking to us.
So you got 7 books?
Yeah, and 2 more coming out this year. Mm. One is a collaboration, and one is my book in entirety.
You said 20 years?
What's that? And I've been in my business for 10 years, been a nurse for 30 years.
It's Wednesday night. How's it going?
It's great. How are you?
I'm good.
Good evening, everybody.
It's your favorite fitness trainer and health coach, Tony Reid.
Yes.
How y'all doing? Yes. Angie, how you doing? I see you brought some backup tonight, huh?
I did. No, we want to enhance you tonight.
Is that what you're trying to do?
We're trying to enhance you tonight.
We got a guest in the house tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Just want to let y'all know. So they're going to try to team up on me. But they don't know. Y'all know I read. So they ain't the one. So, hi, guest. How you doing?
I am doing
Why don't you introduce
fabulous.
Yourself? Tell the world who you are.
I am Cherie M. Good, the Recharge Strategist.
And what does that mean, Cherie?
That means that I teach you the necessity of self-care. You have to put yourself on the plate, and you have to serve yourself first before you serve others.
I like that.
Yes.
So before we get into the questions that I have, you know I got 20 questions for you.
Only 20?
Only 20.
Only 20.
That okay. depends on how your answers go.
So, okay, okay.
You know. But welcome.
Thank you.
Glad to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
I'm glad that Angie coerced us to meet. Since we didn't know about it at all.
Right.
But I do know a colleague of yours, Tracy Newsom.
Yes.
Yes. I trained her for, I guess, about a year or so. And she she did a wonderful job of losing weight and keeping it off.
Yeah.
She really did.
She does a lot with diabetes training and teaching as well. So.
Yeah. So I was happy to see she's on your program also.
She is. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Next month.
I want to have her come in.
Yeah. In fact, I talked to her when I first got to the gym.
Okay.
All right, so tell us about your program that's coming up first.
So February 8th, February is Heart Health Awareness Month. Mm-hmm. So February 8th, we're going to go RID. We're going to recharge and go RID for heart health. So we're going to have not only just some networking and have some red wine, because red wine is good for you, but okay. we're also going to have a heart health panel, which mm-hmm. consists of different areas that make up your excellence of your heart. So mm-hmm. Diabetes, that's where Tracy comes in. Mm-hmm. We actually have a heart disease survivor who's had open heart surgery. She's going to come and talk to us about her experience and what she's doing differently in her life to make sure that she doesn't have another event. Mm-hmm. Also, we have a fitness instructor, Queen D.
Okay.
And then we have Delana Watkins, who is the sugarless diva, mm-hmm. because a lot of people don't put diabetes and heart health together, and they actually have a whole lot to do with one another. And then we'll also be talking about why it's important to make sure that your dental health is intact, because people don't correlate that also with heart health. Right. So we're going to be talking about all of it. We're going to be networking. It's going to be fun, but with a purpose.
Okay. Awesome. Any men on the panel? I just wondered.
No men on the panel. You want to be on the panel?
Not this year, but I still have my red dress thing.
Y'all see how I slid that in, right? Y'all see how I slid that in? I don't want no enemies. Y'all just want friends.
I might do that. But no, I actually did one. I did that 1 year. You were down at the power plant. 1 year, I guess it was about 5 or 6 years ago.
I was at a DoubleTree. You mean DoubleTree Hotel?
I probably went to one of those too.
There and the one down by John Hopkins.
Okay.
Yeah. That's probably one. Yeah, the expos.
So, what are the people expected to learn from your event?
So they're going to learn, first of all, what are some warning signs, because mm-hmm. the warning signs for men and women are totally different. Nine times out of ten, like men. Well, the universal sign is normally like clenching your chest. Oh my God, I have chest pain.
Mm-hmm.
9 times out of 10, a woman is not going to get that
right,
sign.
That's what I've
heard. A woman is going to have jaw pain, maybe back pain, maybe mm-hmm. neck pain, arm pain. So just educating on that, letting people know, don't wait.
Mm-hmm.
Like, don't wait and have the heart attack. You know, if it's happening now, call 911.
Okay. So what about those people that say they feel like they have gas?
Yes, you can have some stomach discomfort, nausea, right. vomiting. But typically it's with other symptoms when you have that nausea, vomiting. Stop eating that Mexican food, they say.
I have not had any in 2020.
All right now.
Okay. Now I'm going to go black on us.
Okay. Let's go.
Now, here's a question that I've heard for the last 20 years.
Okay.
And I just want to know, is there a way for the black man, I'm going to ask for the brothers, okay, because I know the sisters got their own answers. I know they can get the answers the next day. But for us, it's always been told that no matter what we do, we're going to get high blood pressure.
I don't agree with that.
Okay.
Totally not.
Most of the doctors that I've dealt with over the last 20 years is that, well, you're predisposed, you're black, mm-hmm. your risk level says that you're going to get this, you need to do this.
Right.
What can we do to avoid getting even to, because they've changed the numbers now, I understand,
mm-hmm.
to even lower numbers. So where you used to be maybe just pre,
mm-hmm.
now you're actually in right. the zone where you're like, so like 130 to 139, now you're in a high blood pressure zone where you might have to start changing your lifestyle first.
Right. And really it's that bottom number that we're more concerned about
right.
than the top number. Everybody has a baseline.
Mm-hmm.
So your baseline may be 150 over 80. If that's your baseline, that's your baseline.
Mm-hmm.
The bottom number, typically they don't want it to go, they want it to be at 80. So if you get to 90 now, they're saying you're pre-hypertensive or you're already
wow,
hypertensive.
Really?
So they've lowered right. that bottom number.
Right.
So typically the textbook blood pressure is supposed to be 120 over 80.
Right.
Everybody can't be the same. Some people are lower, some people are higher. But the important part is to know your risk. So if you know your risk, you can do things differently to prevent yourself from getting to that point. So heredity has a lot to do with it, but
mm-hmm.
also your diet has a lot to do with it. Your activity level has a lot to do with it. So just because you have predisposing factors don't mean you can't fight against those.
Well, let me ask this question then. Okay. Black man, not overweight.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Exercise weekly.
Okay.
Maintains a good diet, I'll okay. say. What else can they do to fight this, even though they're going in and it's still there? What else is there? Why? Or let me ask this question another way. Why is it that before the medication is given, the medication is given first, why don't they say, well, look, go over here and try the DASH diet or the Mediterranean diet or something like that? Why is that not the first option?
You're trying to get me in trouble in the air.
No, I'm not.
So you know I'm a nurse. Well, I mean, the pharmaceutical business has to get some money. I mean, that's it in a nutshell. So you have to be a spokesperson for your temple, for your body. Mm-hmm. So I've had my pressure be up when I go to the doctors before, and I tell her, no, I'm not going to take any medication. I know why it's up. First of all, when we go to the doctors, we're already nervous because we don't know what they're going
to
tell us.
You're rushing to get
So it's called the white coat syndrome. So when you see that white coat,
I have that.
You automatically, your blood pressure goes up. You're like, what in the world are they going to find? Are they going to tell me something's wrong with me? So a lot of times they take your blood pressure too quickly when you go into the doctor's office. I just had a physical this week, and it happened to me. And my blood pressure was up. It was 142 over 95. Mm-hmm. Oh, my God, your blood pressure is up. Mm-hmm. You took it like 3 minutes after I just walked down the hall, came in, and I was rushing. Rushing to get there on time because me and my crazy self did an 8:30 in the morning appointment. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. But, I'm not a morning person. Right. Okay. So I rushed to get to the doctor. So my blood pressure is going to be up. I'm rushing. I just walked in. Let me relax. She took it. I told her, take it again at the end of the visit. She took it again at the end of the visit. It was normal.
Okay.
It was like 130 something over 80. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And she's like, okay. I said, I know my body. So it's important for you to know your body. And we know when we're hypertensive, honestly. You can feel it.
Okay. And the reason I asked that question is because that actually happened to me today around 2 o'clock. I go in. I actually get there at 1:30. So I sit in the waiting room. I read for a little bit. And then the woman takes me in, sits me in this nice, comfortable chair, and takes my blood pressure. Well, my thought process today was that I was going to meet my doctor and was going to have this nice conversation, but the white coat syndrome did kick in. Mm-hmm. So the first time she took it, she says, it's a little high. Why don't I come back in 10 minutes?
Okay,
I was cool with that. Mm-hmm. She came back in 10 minutes. It went down. But here's the thing that happened. Because it was still up, yeah, I'm going to get you in trouble right now. What was so scary today was that she went to another doctor because my doctor wasn't there, and he sent some medication back to me and said, oh, well, have him go downstairs and take this for the next 2 weeks and come back. now my question is, and I want to make sure that people understand this, and this is how I understand it, is that when you start these medications, you can't just say in 2 weeks, stop.
Stop it. Exactly.
There's a process for this. And I tell people that medications like blood pressure, diabetes medicine, cholesterol medicines, those are mandatory medications daily.
Yes.
It's not like, okay, well, I'm going to just have a drink on Friday. No, you need to take them every day.
Exactly.
So my question to the person was, I said, well, can I come off of these? Well, yeah, you can.
They must don't know what you do. Like, that you know this already.
I'm sitting there with this on and this on too.
Well, I mean
that stuff, it don't mean that they
I'm gonna say this. You can come off of blood pressure medication, but you have to be weaned off. You can't just stop it.
Right.
Because what you're doing when you're taking a blood pressure pill is you're opening up your blood vessels so you can get more blood flow. So that your heart isn't working, so your system is not working as hard to get that blood to your heart. Okay. So when you take it and then you stop, it's like opening and closing the valve. You're doing like this. Mm-hmm. And you're putting pressure, then you're opening it up. You're putting pressure, you're opening it up. You're predisposing yourself to blood clots. Mm-hmm. You're predisposing yourself to heart disease, heart attacks. So my recommendation would have been, do you check your blood pressure at home?
Yes, I did.
So when you check your blood pressure at home, now I'm not talking about one time. I would say keep a log of your blood pressure for the next week or two, then come back and see me, and then we can evaluate what your blood pressure is to see if there's a necessity for you to have blood pressure medication. So he has his cuff. Hey, everybody.
No, but show them how small that is, though.
It's very small. It's a wrist. He has a wrist one. It's very
good. That can help you. That's one that can help you at home.
Yes. And he has a good one. He has the Orion. I love the Orion brand.
Oh, good.
I use that for work. I use one of those for work. It's one of the best ones that's most accurate.
Okay. So is that correct?
So hold that up over here so they can see. Hold on. See. There we go. Yeah. So that's how he has it on.
Okay. Is that correct, though?
Is that is correct.
Now, question, since you're here, should my arm be like this to test it, or should it be up here?
You really want it at heart level. So okay. You want it a little higher, but, you know, I mean, typically arm rest is okay, and just have the bottom part of your arm a little elevated here. So you can still rest your elbow, because most people can't hold their arm up that long. So having it either, you know, on the table or having it on the armrest with it slightly elevated so it can be near your heart.
So you do it on the wrist. Yes, where you don't do that on the arm. It don't go up on this part.
No, this goes
not this one. This this particular
part. I have the other one, too.
But you can use either one.
Okay. I've never seen that type. I've only seen
and this one works one really like well, especially in the older population, because a lot of times the skin gets thinner and it's frail. So when you squeeze the upper arm, it's painful. Mm-hmm. So the wrist is less painful.
Yep. Awesome.
So I would say keep a journal of your blood pressure if blood pressure is an issue for you.
Mm-hmm.
Keep a journal for a week or two before you go to your doctor, or once you see your doctor, before you just let them throw you on a medication, you know, make sure that it's actually hypertension and not just one occasion or just that one day that you're feeling stressed out. Or.
So what about the fluid pill? When they say they're giving you the fluid
pill. That's the D. That's the D I ran. Right. There's an A, B, C, and D.
Okay, so if you get just the fluid pill.
He's been reading, y'all. He's been reading.
I told you.
They done set me up.
But no, so,
With the fluid pill, though.
That's the D. That's the diuretic. D.
Right. Mm-hmm. So that's supposed to just help keep the fluid off. But can you just come off of that, too?
No.
Or you have to be weaned off of that?
It just depends on your...
Because they told me just take it for the 2 weeks when I took
it. I was going to say, it depends on your reason why you're having it. If he's taking it for hypertension, then he probably has to take it all the time.
Okay.
But probably a low dose. If they're doing it specifically because you have congestive heart failure or fluid all on your body and they're trying to drain it, it may be like, hey, take 40 for a week and then go down to 20 for a week and then you can stop it. It just depends on the purpose for the medication.
Okay.
So it is a diuretic. It's going to make you urinate more, helps keep your blood pressure down, keeps fluid off your body, keeps your heart from working so hard and keeps fluid from around your heart. Yeah.
See, I told you I know a little bit of something.
He know a little bit about a lot, y'all.
A little bit of something,
But, yes,
you know,
he do.
But here's a question that and I know that you guys are probably going to deal with this in your event. What should people do and where should they actually go for the alternative health care? I mean, are there people out there? I know,
right.
I mean, I don't, you know, for me, I'm saying go check with your doctor first. And then choose and, you know, ask questions about that. But what's the other alternatives that people have? Because I see a lot of people in my profession taking a lot of medication, not knowing how to eat, not knowing what to eat.
Right.
I mentioned, you know, the DASH diet or the Mediterranean diet or, you know, and they're like clueless. So where can they go?
You can call me.
Okay.
I educate on the different diets. That's actually one of the books I have coming out this year. Well, actually next month, the beginning of next month, about intermittent fasting and sugarless living. So it's a quick guide to intermittent fasting and sugarless living. So changing your diet, changing what you eat, cutting the sodium, eating more fruit and vegetables, doing more of a plant-based diet, lean meats, protein, getting protein from your fish, doing things like that. Help to lower like your cholesterol level, help to lower your BMI, which, you know, which your body's mass index. A lot of people don't even know what that is or how to calculate it. So making sure that they know.
They think about that.
And, I mean, everybody's Googleicious. I mean, people Google all the time.
Let me ask you a question now, because I had a fight about that too. BMI and body fat.
Okay.
Two different things. With your BMI, it's usually based on your waist size and your height. Those are the two factors. And so, and then there's a calculation that comes up and it gives you your BMI.
Yep.
But if I'm 6'2 and I'm 300, my BMI is higher.
Right.
If I'm 6'7 and 300, my BMI is lower.
Right. That's correct.
So if a person is looking at that, and it usually can throw them in the obesity category. And does that, should they be that concerned for it, or should they be more concerned about their body fat as opposed to their BMI?
I think both plays a role. 25 or less is considered the healthy
BMI. Right.
For everybody across the board. If you get under 18, then you're malnourished. So I just think, I mean, just like your blood pressure, you have your own baseline. So you're right. going to have your own baseline for your BMI too, but we don't want to go over 30. You know, I would say that between the 25 and 30 range, you want to stay there, but typically stay closer to 25, regardless of what weight you are or what height you are.
Yeah, but okay, in my case, if I actually kept at the BMI, then I would probably have to be 20 pounds lighter than what I am.
And you probably wouldn't need that blood pressure film.
Well, I'm actually 20 pounds lighter than what I was when they started telling me that.
So. Okay.
So that's what I'm saying. So, and I still haven't taken the blood pressure medicine yet.
Good for you.
Okay.
But if you can do things to avoid taking a pill, then do them.
So yeah. that is the question that I keep saying, you know, where can we find this information? And are there a great number of resources out there for people to go to and actually get educated on that? Because when you talk to people about it, they're just like, well, the doctor put me on this medicine, the doctor put me on that medicine. And there's never a push to have them come off of it.
Right.
Which I understand why.
Yeah. And I mean, if you don't speak up for yourself and you're taking everything they push your way, then they're going to keep doing it, right? Okay. If a pill will fix it, that's what they'll do.
And most people can live with the pill.
And most people, and I'm not one of those people.
I can't
stand, no. I have a hard time taking a vitamin. So I'm going to do everything I can do.
Day.
I mean, like literally, well, see, when my doctor said,
that.
I want to put you on a blood pressure.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
it scared me to death when she told me, I'm going to put you on a blood pressure. But I said, well, no, you're not. I know why my blood pressure's up. I'm going to do it. And then I went back to her 2 weeks later. It was like 120 over 70. She's like, oh, you show off. You just wanted to come in here and show me your blood pressure was low.
I did that one time too.
Yeah. Why not? Hey, you gonna give me a pill I really didn't need.
So in your, you know, off the record opinion, just us here. No. But when we start looking at it, and this is still on the black side of it for right now.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are predisposed. What would you suggest that we do to really educate ourselves about taking care of ourselves as we get older? Mm-hmm. You know, because it seems as we get older, we have more doctor's appointment than we have dates. So,
that is funny. Definitely reading, getting educated, and knowing your body.
Okay.
Because what's working for you may not work for me.
Okay.
I became pescatarian this year.
Okay.
Why? Because I listened to my body. My body started rejecting meat. So I haven't had beef or pork in like 10 years now.
Okay.
But I was still eating chicken and turkey.
Mm-hmm.
But I started feeling sick every time I would eat that. I'm like, listen to your body. Why are you putting yourself through this?
I started getting into it.
So knowing your body, knowing your body's reaction to food, knowing your body's reaction to different things that you're doing. I like, in as far as eating is a big thing because our food is killing us. Literally, eating is major. So I always say, dump the crap and eat the crow. Dump those concentrated, those refined, those processed foods and eat crow, that clean, raw, organic, whole foods that are going to make you feel whole inside. So diet is a big part of it to me.
Now, I found another way of shopping, and I shared this with Angie a few weeks ago. When I go in and I pick up food now, I actually, you did not spam call, okay. Not even an emergency. Okay, when I pick up food and I'm looking at it because of blood pressure, what I do in a market is I actually type in the food and say, and blood pressure.
That's smart.
And some of the time that this food will come up, but it'll have all these other side effects that are being sold in our markets.
Oh, yeah.
So how do we get people, you know, we tell people, you know, do the perimeter, stay with the fruits, stay with this, stay with that. But a lot of times, some of the foods that are sitting there safe, that we think are safe because it's being sold there, is banned in other countries. What else can we tell people to do when they're trying to eat better because of whatever their condition is, cholesterol, diabetes, or whatever? What else can we tell them to do when they go into the market?
the biggest thing you said is reading labels. Mm-hmm. We don't read labels. We say, oh, it looks good. Let me pick it up. Let me go.
Mm-hmm.
Staying away from the canned items. You want to do fresh, frozen. Fresh or frozen. Mm-hmm. Those are the ones that's going to have less sodium. Anything prepackaged, they have to keep it fresh for you to want to buy it.
Right.
So if it's prepackaged, that means it's loaded with sugar or salt to keep it fresh for you to even want it. So if it's prepackaged, if it's something you can just pop in the microwave and eat, if it's something that it's already cooked, it's fresh for a reason. It's because it's loaded with sodium. So stay away from those items. Mm-hmm. Stay fresh or frozen. That's the biggest thing. Stay away from things with dyes in it. So sodas and juices and all that good stuff. The best thing you can drink is water.
Okay.
For yourself. So I would say stay away from that. Stay away from that deli. Stay away from the deli, y'all. Stay away from the deli.
Yes, he talked about the deli a couple weeks ago. Yeah. He talked about
like laughing.
Because people really get it missed. They really mess up when they go to they be buying. I'm standing there one day after you had that session and you just realize how you just watching these people buy all this processed meat. And they thinking they because I'm looking at the turkey like you said. That turkey ain't a turkey.
Ain't no wings on it. You see any wings
They made it a turkey.
And again, it's prepackaged.
It's so prepackaged.
Look, if you just look at the package that they cut open,
it's sealed.
You can
it's
see sealed. The juice is not clear. It's cloudy.
Right.
Why? Because it's full of fat. And it's full of salt. Mm. A lot of sugar to keep it fresh, so you want to buy it. And then you're paying those astronomical prices to kill yourself. Because now lunch meat is like, if you want boar's head, like, it's like $10, $11 a pound.
Yes.
So, like, you are paying to kill yourself. You're paying for diabetes and high blood pressure. All
right. Let's see how much more time we got. Okay. You know, because I got, like, 20 questions.
You got 20 more questions, y'all.
No, but okay. Now, if a person comes to you in your profession and what you do, what should they expect? As an initial consultation to talk to them.
So if they do an initial consultation, my focus is holistic.
Okay.
Mind, body, spirit. We're like a puzzle. It's three pieces to us. Mental, physical, emotional, or spiritual. So if any of those pieces is bent, broke, missing, think about a real puzzle.
Mm-hmm.
You don't get a clear picture.
Okay.
So you can't get a clear picture of who you are if you're not whole. So I teach recharge pillars of self-care.
Okay.
So self-care is everything. If you're taking care of yourself, if you're nurturing yourself, if you're doing the things you're supposed to do to stay healthy, then it's going to decrease the likelihood that you're going to end up with a serious health event or a serious health, you know, diseases.
Mm.
So I teach putting yourself first on a plate, making sure that you're advocating for yourself like you were when you went to the doctor,
right.
Making sure your nutrition is on point, staying hydrated, making sure that you're making healthy choices, movement, making sure you're exercising, like, if you're going to do vigorous exercises, you should be doing at least 1 hour and 15 minutes weekly. And if you're doing moderate exercises, it should be at least 2.5 hours a week.
Let me ask you a question. The 1 hour and 15 minutes weekly.
Yep.
Okay, you let them know they need to split that up.
It depends.
Some people call me and say, can I come in once a week and work out? And I'm like,
Well, that's better than nothing, but you know, I mean, you can split it up in smaller segments.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
You can do 15, 20 minute power walks. And then do that 3 to 5 times a week, right. And then you still have your hours.
Mm-hmm.
But it's all about your schedule. We want to take all the excuses out. So if you can only do it one day a week, I'd rather you do the 1 hour 15 minutes in one day.
Okay, well, I'm going to just have you walk know. To.
And then have him walk after that. He's trying. Whatever it takes, you know, right. Everybody knows their schedule, and you know your activity tolerance also.
Mm-hmm.
But just making sure that you're moving your body. Then after you move your body and you're doing all these other roles that you're playing in life, making sure that you're taking time to relax.
Mm-hmm.
And then with that relaxation, maybe do some meditation where you have focused breathing, where you're actually staying in the moment. You're relaxing. You're noticing how your body works. And then forgiveness and healing. A lot of people are holding on to things that happened 15, 20 years ago, and it continues.
50 years ago.
50 years ago. You continue to let yourself be haunted
right.
by something that hurt you.
Which really
so it's up to you how long you let what hurt you haunt you.
Mm-hmm.
So making sure that you forgive, and sometimes the forgiveness is for ourselves, forgiving ourselves to make sure we can move forward and be the person that we really want to be in life. Forget what you did in the past. Everybody makes mistakes. Nobody's perfect. If they say they are, they're lying. And then healing, the forgiveness and the healing is like together.
Mm-hmm.
And then last but not least, once we do all those things and we feel like we are whole, then we celebrate big and small accomplishments every day. So those are the 8 recharge pillars of self-care that I teach. You have to celebrate yourself. If you don't celebrate yourself, what's it all for?
And where can people find you?
They can find me on social media at Cherie M. Good, okay. Or they can visit my website, TotalHarmonyEnterprises.com. Okay. Yep, I'm on all your social media, so I'm easy to find. Google me.
Now, let me ask this question, too. We know that people should start working on being preventive, yes, for certain things. Mm-hmm. What are the ones that can be reversed? Or can they be reversed? Like if you're, say, before you have the heart attack, mm-hmm, can you reverse the process and maybe get back down to the normal blood pressure? Is that possible?
You can't reverse the damage that's already been done. Mm-hmm. What you can do is prevent further damage.
Okay.
So some damage we're already doing just by, I mean, we might have did it when we were 16, 17. 10 years later, we're feeling the results of it, right? From partying, drinking, mm-hmm, whatever. But you can prevent further damage, which slows down the disease process. Mm-hmm. So that's the important part, preventing further damage. If you're a diabetic, you'll always be labeled a diabetic, mm-hmm, but you can do things to have a healthy blood sugar.
Okay.
Yeah. And now maybe get off the insulin, maybe get off of the glucophage and all the other medications that, okay, that you have, mm-hmm, for diabetes, just by changing your diet alone, you know, focusing maybe just meat and vegetable, mm-hmm, instead of having a lot of starch.
Is there a recommended diet that for people, I know I talk a lot about the Mediterranean diet, the DASH, mm-hmm, diet. Is there a diet that people can go to a nutritionist and actually talk to them about and work through it?
Yeah, definitely they can do that. They can go to a nutritionist. Now the supermarkets are having nutritionists in the supermarkets now. Mm-hmm. Well, you actually can have a one-on-one consultation with a nutritionist for free. So that, also just try and see how your body feels on different things. So I do intermittent fasting, mm-hmm, to give my, mm-hmm, gut a rest because everything goes back to the gut. Now they're going back and saying like mental illness, things like schizophrenia and bipolar, it's because there's a component missing in the gut. So everything starts with your gut health. If your belly is not right, you're going to start feeling, mm-hmm, ill some way or another. So making sure that you have a healthy gut.
I was going to say, can you elaborate a little bit, yeah, on that intermittent fast? Because people, you know, he just talked about it last week, mm-hmm, dealing, mm-hmm, with the fasting, dealing with the detoxing, and how when they're detoxing, they don't realize they're detoxing the medicines that they're on. Mm-hmm. That's why when they go back to the doctors, their numbers are, yes, not right. So yes, can you talk about your intermittent fasting that, yeah, you do, and, okay, how is it... how is it healthy for you? Because, okay, we can't say it works for,
right,
everybody.
It doesn't work for everybody. And if you're diabetic, mm-hmm, you may not want to be the one that fasts. You know, you're sleeping when you're...
He just said all this last week.
So you reiterated... Yeah, all right, y'all. I'm set me up.
Sheila, I'm, yeah, surprised she's not on here.
Yeah, tonight. if you're diabetic, you may not want to do intermittent fasting. Your fast is going to be when you're sleeping. If you're diabetic. Uh-huh. So you have to know how your body reacts to whatever you are deciding to do for your own self-care, healthcare regimen. Mm-hmm. So... I started intermittent fasting. First, I started cutting sugar. Mine was for weight loss. Nobody told me I was getting fat. Nobody told me my face was like, I was pie face. Nobody told me. But I looked at pictures of myself and I was like, oh my God, I gained weight. And so I started just cutting sugar. I did Delaina Watkins, Sugarless Diva. I did her program, her sugarless program where I was only doing 10 grams or less of sugar a day. Mm-hmm. And so I started dropping weight. I was losing like 11, 15, 20 pounds. And then I started fasting. I added it on. So maybe do one thing at a time. Don't try to jump all in. Oh, I'm going to cut the sugar. I'm going to intermittent fast and I'm going to do keto. No, you're going to crash.
Right.
You're going to crash.
You're going to crash.
Do one thing at a time and, mm-hmm, see how your body responds to that. What works for somebody may not work for you. So you have to look at your body's response. Maybe give yourself two to three weeks to see how that regimen works for you first before you jump onto something else. So I was okay with cutting the sugar. It was a battle, you know. You go through some stuff because, mm-hmm, okay, sugar is in everything, right, and we don't even realize how much is in. So the whole thing is getting your sugar through natural sources, like, yeah, your fruit, mm-hmm, not adding sugar to anything, even your beverages, like, you know, even honey is sugar, like. People think about that, but you have to count all of that. And then when I added the intermittent fasting, I started just not eating breakfast. I cut breakfast out because I'm not a big breakfast person anyway. So I said it'll be easier for me to wait until lunchtime to eat because I'm not a morning person, so I don't want to eat. So I fast from 8 p.m. to 12 noon every day. So I stop eating after 8, and then I eat at 12 noon. Okay. And then when you're eating at 12 noon, eat something sensible. Don't go and be like, oh, okay, I need that Big Mac, this, that. No, you have to eat sensibly to align with what you're trying to do with your body. What it does is it gives your gut a break. It gives it a rest. And you can naturally detox. People take these detoxes. You really don't have to do that. You can naturally detox by eating fresh fruit and vegetables.
You just confirming our session last week. You are just confirming everything we discussed last week. Because that is so important, what you're saying.
But I need you to explain to them again, because we talked about detox.
Right.
And from my understanding, that it flushes the system. Now, I know we talked about this too. If a person is on medications, what about, does it take that out of the system, and how does that affect the person overall if it's taking your insulin and your blood pressure medicine? What should they do in that case?
So it can take at least some of it out. It may not take all of it out, depending on how the last time you took it and the absorption rate of the medication. But if you're detoxing and you're stripping everything, first of all, when you detox and it's not natural, you're stripping out some of the bacteria in your gut that you need to fight off infections. And so, so you don't want to strip everything out. You need
degree
some.
Got me some, girl.
You need some bacteria in your gut to be able to fight off stuff. Okay. That's why, you know, some people, you know, if they sneeze, they if you sneeze, they got it.
Right.
Because their gut is probably being stripped of some bacteria that they really, really need. As far as the medications, you have to tread lightly. When you're on medication, you have to watch those diets, fads, all that. You cannot just go and jump on everything when you're on medication. You have to do your research. You have to know how your body responds. Detoxing can strip out necessary proteins, especially for women. We need more protein than men do. And I think he's over here. Ooh, he amen. I got the amen corn over here, y'all. Women need more protein than men. And sometimes we're going on these diets and we're really depleting ourselves. And we're wondering why we're going through mood swings and all of this kind of stuff. But it's because we're stripping.
Mental.
Right?
All kinds.
Because it does. It messes with your mentality, yes, you know. Yes. So, and again, if you're on medication, tread lightly. Discuss any diet, any kind of regimen you're going to do with your doctor before you do it. Not after, while you're doing it. Talk to the doctor first and say, I'm thinking about doing blah, blah, blah. Is this safe with the medications I'm on? And don't just take their word for it. Go and do your research. Y'all like to Google. Go to Dr. Google and look it up on Google. Read it. And it's okay to print out some stuff and take it to your doctor. Listen, I've read this. What's the validity of this? It's okay. Question them. They are human too.
You know, I'm only right once a year, but I got my... So I'm good for this year, right?
I'm good
for this year.
Everything we have discussed since the first week of January.
You have
confirmed
everything.
Oh, good. And this is why I knew she would be a good fit for your show, Tony.
You can come back anytime.
He's like, come back anytime. Yeah, at the stamp of approval, y'all.
Right. No, okay, now, the other question I have, because every label has milligrams on it. Okay.
You talking about medications?
Well, medications and foods.
Oh, and
too.
Foods. Okay. All right.
So now there's a difference in the amount of grams that you can have per day, say in sodium.
Right. Right.
And there's a difference in, but they show milligrams. Why is that? Because that can
confuse you.
Because you're thinking, okay, well, 600 milligrams.
Right.
Oh, that may, for me, that's going to be high because I think that what is the daily, like 2500
or less.
But if you're trying to cut your blood pressure, you need to go down to about 1500.
Yes.
Right. So,
but the thing is, they know we don't read labels, so they don't care. We'll smack it on there. Just put the milligrams on there. They're not going to read it anyway.
Right. That's what
you're not going to. They're not going to read it anyway. They're going to see it. See? It's a pretty picture on the can or on the package, and that's what they want. They're going to eat it.
They are determined.
Tell me your name again and where they can find you.
I am Cherie M. Good.
They don't know that I know stuff, but go ahead.
I am Cherie M. Good, the Recharge Strategist. Find me at TotalHarmonyEnterprises.com on all your social media sites. Cherie M. Good. Good with the E on the end.
Yes. See. I'm just letting y'all know. See, y'all didn't think I knew what I was talking about, but now
he knows a lot about a little.
That's right. I read the first pages over there and everything.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing that I find that with us is still going black on this. With our culture, we don't talk about fitness the way other folks do. You know, and there's an obsession in other cultures with fitness, health, and all of that. How do we, or how do you bring people over to this church and say, okay, let me give you the gospel about fitness.
Right.
As opposed to, you know, because of the way it is right now. What do you do?
So I host events. Okay. Mm-hmm. So typically I have one group called Ladies Recharge, mm-hmm. where we get together and we talk health and wellness, or we may just do something fun, but people want to have fun nowadays. Everything's about fun. Mm-hmm. So you have to meet people where they are.
So you bring
I bring the wine. Yeah, we're going to have wine next month, y'all. But it's going to be red wine because it has to be with a purpose. Mm-hmm. So we just bring people together. I've done the Health Expo for 9 years, showing people that fitness can be fun. You're mm-hmm. not at this alone. It's a journey for everybody. Anybody who looks at my social media pages, you see I show the good, the bad, the ugly. I'm like, y'all are messed up. I ate this today. Or, hey, here's another way to blacken a salmon. Put some onions with it. Flavor it up. Make it look colorful. You know, educating subtly, but making it fun, letting people know it doesn't have to be so serious. Have fun with it. Even if it's just you running around the block or having races in your neighborhood with your kids, make it a fun journey. It doesn't have to be something that, oh my God, I have to go to the gym. You don't have to go to the gym. You have a house, you have stairs, you can make it fun. I bet you, you know, bet a family member, do whatever it mm-hmm. takes just to stay active, but make it fun, make it enjoyable so you still feel like you're getting something out of life, but then you're serving the same purpose of staying healthy, staying fit, staying active, recharging your internal batteries, mind, body, and spirit by staying active.
Okay, is my other $20 million question.
Uh-oh, $20 million. I want my check.
for the people who may, and we all say that it's expensive to eat healthy.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's more expensive to buy pills and pay medical bills after the fact.
Right. But what if you're that person who is dealing with the canned goods? How can mm-hmm. we... What can we do if we're buying canned beans, canned greens? Is there any way of reducing the salt and the sodium intake if we have to buy canned for vegetables?
If it's possible, you can rinse off the vegetable.
Okay.
Don't add any more seasoning to it.
Okay.
So it when it however it comes out of the can, that's it. Because, mm-hmm. you know, we'll dump some more salt and all that kind of stuff on it. Right. Okay. It's okay to use other seasoning, but not salt. You know, mm-hmm. you don't want to add more salt to a can of salt. But, you know, you have to eat within your means. So some mm-hmm. people can't afford to eat healthier, you know, so and that's understood. Right. And that's probably where you're going to find those foods that you shouldn't consume the most, because we know that you can't afford more. So they're going to make sure that those things are well stocked in that store, because they know that's all you can afford to buy. So we have to take other ways. Like you said, rinse them off, making sure that the nutrients stay in your vegetables, so not adding a bunch of water to your vegetables. Mm-hmm. Typically, if you're going to dump it out of a can into the pot, only cook it in that amount of water.
Okay.
And cook it slowly so the water doesn't boil out. You don't have to add extra water, because that takes the nutrients out the longer you cook your vegetables. That would be my biggest thing. And then maybe limit how much you're going to eat, especially if it's full of sodium.
Okay. Because I know people are saying, I need a can of mm-hmm. beans, and I can't.
Mm-hmm. And they have less sodium vegetables and things like that. So use the less sodium, option instead.
What
of
about
just
them adding the meats that they add?
Ooh. Yeah, let's avoid adding the meats. Yes,
you know they take that bacon that they dip a whole thing in there. To make the
You can season your foods without meat. It is mm-hmm. possible, and you know if you are a meat eater, then instead of using the pork, maybe use the turkey option to season if you have to have meat in your vegetables.
Are there, at your events, are there any cooking demonstrations for people? Because most people don't know how
to have.
Yeah.
Because most people don't know how to cook greens and kale without the meat.
Exactly. At the health expos that I've hosted, we have had Chef Vaughn has been there, Chef Terrence has been there, and they actually cook the food right in front of you to show you that you don't have to use salt, and that it can be a nutritious, delicious meal without having those unhealthy, you know, options, and then using a vegan or plant-based option instead of using meat. And it's been a hit every time. People are like, wow, I never thought to do it like that. Mm-hmm. And they tear it up. You know? So there are options to everything. There's a way around everything and still have the enjoyment of the foods that you like. Just altering a few things about it to make it a little healthier.
Okay. next question. You know, you go to Giants and we got the processed meat over here and the lunch meat and all that. Then they have these trays of vegetables.
Right.
Like the green kale and macaroni. Is it made fresh or is it more processed because of the way it's put together? Because I know they don't stand there and...
You mean the ones in the deli?
That you buy in the deli? Yeah, and then you buy it by the pound and the half a pound in the cup.
Oh, no. Yeah, it's processed.
It's all processed.
It's all processed because whatever they don't sell, they're going to package it up and put it in the refrigerator. It has to stay fresh somehow. So you know it has components
just
in it.
Just wanted to know.
Just wanted to know.
I definitely need that one.
No, I mean, because, you know, the reason I ask that is because mm-hmm. a lot of people will go to the deli,
yeah.
see these mm-hmm. trays of vegetables, oh, yeah. which are, mm-hmm. you know, you got the broccoli.
Well, you got the cooking bags now, though, Tony. You know that with the vegetables and the meat all in there. I'm just saying that you can buy a piece of, you can buy the meat. It comes all mm-hmm. in a cooking bag, seasoned, mm-hmm. ready to just mm-hmm. go home. Pop it in a convection oven
and
or microwave.
Until 2012.
I'm just saying, that's what they doing. And I've been guilty of buying a salmon. It came with the salmon broccoli because mm-hmm. I was late leaving here.
Right.
And, you know, to avoid eating mm-hmm. real bad.
Right,
you
right.
know, like to stop.
You be like, I'll just eat a little bad instead of a lot
bad. Because when, you know, you ride past the market and you hoping it's closed, but you saw they weren't closed yet. So you said, okay, let me go on and just grabbed the cooking bag that had the piece
right.
of salmon.
Uh-huh.
The ear corn and some broccoli in there, and they didn't have any seasoning on those pieces. The meat, of course, had a little something on there, and then you just throw it in the microwave when you get home, and then you eat it.
That's a whole other story, that microwave.
You know, or you can do a convection oven.
Don't go there. He said, don't go there. He told me, don't go there with the microwave.
People got microwaves out there right now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Microwave in the microwave with a convection.
I have a girlfriend that does not use a microwave. She does not
have.
She does not have one. I use it less now. Than what I used to.
Yeah.
I like my food fresh. I mean, I'm not a big leftover person anyway, but I like my food fresh. But that microwave,
I've really gotten away from
using
it.
That's the next time I come. We'll talk about the microwave next time I come.
Yeah, I've really gotten away from using that.
That's a whole other story. You gotta break it down.
Yes, yes.
Them folks ain't throwing their microwaves away right
now.
They're
not throwing away
No.
Because they want everything in zip.
Yep.
But I've gotten back to, and I don't know if it was because when I moved in my new house, I went away from using the microwave so much.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what it was. I don't know. Maybe because I got to reach up to it. It's too high. I got to step up on the step stool.
You keep having that problem.
I got to use the step stool to get to the microwave.
Right.
But like, I literally have gotten back away from, because I didn't used to use it at all.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't even have one time.
Right.
And then I eventually bought one, you know, this was years ago, and then kind of got lazy with it, was always heating stuff up in the microwave. But I was always a cooker and heat up stuff in the oven.
Right.
Like, I was an old school heat up person. Like, you know, put it in the oven, wait for it to get real, you know, get hot and stuff like that.
And we
that.
Don't just put it in the microwave and walk away. We stand right in front of it.
4 minutes.
Wait for the food to get done. They're like, oh, 4 minutes. All those waves just going through your body.
Right there.
Just fry me up. Like, oh.
Let me ask you this question now. You talked about earlier the symptoms for men and women when it comes to blood pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Is it because women will maybe ignore the symptoms more than a man? You know, because if we get that chest pain, you know, we sit down and, you know, y'all might stay up and, you know, I got to take care of the baby. I got to take care of this. I got to drive the kids to soccer.
Yep.
Is that the reason? Because, I know I've heard that when it happens for a woman, it's the heart attack.
It's
not anything in between at all. It's just straight out.
There's this video out of this lady. She's having a heart attack. But she's packing the baby bag. She's cleaning the house. She's doing everything except having the heart attack. And I said, that is it. Women, that's why that's my target audience. Because we take care of everybody else first and we put ourselves last on our plate. So we make sure our boo okay. We make sure the kid's okay. We will forego our needs to take care of the needs of others. And so we're trying to turn that around and make sure that women know that self-care does not mean that you're selfish. It means that now you are choosing your health so that you can be around long enough to care for the other people that you love in your life. But women, you're right. We do everything else. Men, you're the last ones to go to the doctors. We'll go to the doctors quicker than you. But men don't want to go to the doctors. They will. They're like, okay, let me just sit here for a couple minutes.
Not this one.
Not him. But they're like, let me sit here for a couple minutes.
I use it like an ATM card. Trust me.
He's like an ATM card. Trust me.
They gotta give me a new one now.
But yeah, I mean, but like the statistics are scary. 1 in 3 women die annually from a heart disease. 1 in 4 men. Mm-hmm. Every 80 seconds, somebody has a heart attack. That's crazy. That's like 1 minute and 20 seconds. Somebody has a heart attack.
Wow.
When you think about those numbers, and it's the number one cause of death in the United States. So it's definitely a serious matter. February is all about heart health, going red for heart health. So you'll be seeing a lot from me about heart health next month. I see the end results. Being a nurse for over 30 years, I see the end results of people who have had the heart attacks and how it shakes and rocks their world and changes everything about them. So if you can prevent it, it's definitely the best bet for you.
What about them people who decide they're going to take that aspirin?
Aspirin is okay. If you think you're in the middle of an event, please pop the aspirin, but still call 911. Mm-hmm. Don't take the aspirin and be like, oh, I'm good, I took the aspirin. No. Take the aspirin and call 911. Or call 911, then take the aspirin.
And make sure somebody in the house knows CPR.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
But think about those people that live by themselves. That's
go knock on a neighbor's door. Mm-hmm. Knock on a neighbor's door, call a neighbor.
Go outside and fall out.
Yep, exactly.
Do not stay in the house and fall out. Go outside.
And the crazy part is, like, when you talk about falling out, women are less likely to receive CPR than men. Yes. Even like in malls, everything. Women are less likely to receive CPR because of the sensitive area is between the women's breasts. So women are less likely to receive CPR. Yep.
Hey. Yep. Yeah. Wow, learn something.
So we're educating people. If you're in the mall and you see somebody you need a defibrillator, it's near the Victoria's Secret.
Yeah. They're putting them more in, even on the office building.
Yeah, they are.
So we have them like sporadically. Yep. And they're kind of requesting that people put them in their churches and things of that nature. So hopefully the churches will get on board with that because it is important to have. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let me see. It is 8:22. You have to be somewhere?
I do. I have another interview. I have to talk heart health with another group.
Well, I'm going to see if they don't have a topic.
Okay.
And we can have you come back.
Awesome.
And if they don't have a topic, you're going to be back in about a few minutes.
10 minutes. Yep.
So give them your information before you leave in case you can't come back.
Okay. Again, I can be reached on all your social media sites at Cherie M. Good. That's C-H-E-R-E, the letter M, and Good with an E on the end. Or you can visit my website, TotalHarmonyEnterprises.com. Make sure you sign up for my monthly newsletter where I give self-care, recharge tips. I give offers. I give freebies, y'all. I give really good freebies, let me tell you. So you might want to sign up for the monthly newsletter.
All right. And the date of...
February 8th from 3 to 6 p.m. Mm-hmm. It's men and women are both invited to come. It's going to be at Suite 207 on North Avenue, 207 East North Avenue, right across from the Board of Education. Okay. There's a, it looks like a townhouse, but it has suites inside. And so we're going to have the main floor, and we're going to have some music. We're going to have some fun, some networking, some light refreshments, some red wine. And then we're going
to
have the panel
have sweet
discussion.
You tell them about the red wine real quick. Sweet or dry? Which is good for the heart? Because see, I mean,
red over anything, but... Again, if you're watching your sugar, you have to watch wine, period, because it does have a lot of sugar.
Yeah, y'all only get one glass.
Yeah, one glass for you.
Per day.
Per day.
Per day.
Okay. Per day. So you one glass a day.
Yeah. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for coming. It's been a pleasure, and we hope to have you back soon, even if it's not tonight. Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much. Your favorite fitness trainer and health coach, Tony Reid, signing off. See y'all next week.
Have a great
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.